Welcome to Blow!
Check out our menu. Choose from a variety of fresh ingredients. Check out our salsa. Watch your burrito being made. Enjoy! Moe's Nose Catering, burritos, tacos, and more.
Live from Moe's Southwest Grill in Cameron Village, Raleigh, North Carolina, is the site of Over the Boards with Mike Gazzillo, the monthly NC State Ice Hockey Coaches Show. As always, we have to thank our sponsors here at Moe's Southwest Grill, live at this location at Cameron Village. You can also visit them online for all your Moe's Southwest Grill catering needs at 919.catering.moes.com or by phone 919-999-3999. Coach, second episode of the season. We've got a whole lot of hockey to talk about, but thanks so much for being back with us.
Yep. Thanks for having me.
As always, I'm Drew Blevins, your host. Our next show will be coming up at the end of November. From now until March, it'll be the third Friday of every month right here at Moe's Cameron Village. Coach, we hop right into things as your team takes on the Elon Phoenix on the road. It's a conference matchup that does not count toward the ACCHL standings. This is a proving ground for NC State. You throw Brian Nelson into the net and are able to come out with a slight, albeit big, win.
Yeah, I mean, it was a good chance for him to get in there and get in the game. Joey had played before that. You know, the guys were firing on all cylinders, and we played up there. The ice was in a lot better shape. And worked out well for us.
So it's a big win against Elon by a final count of 4-2, sort of knocking off the rust before heading into Clemson in South Carolina. This is one of those tramping grounds that's sort of uncharted territory. You have played Clemson before, but it's not necessarily considered a rivalry. It's not an every-year opponent. This is a big game and one that your team almost lost. It takes a last-minute and an overtime goal to be able to tie and eventually win that contest. What does that say about the resiliency and intestinal fortitude of your team?
Yeah, I mean, I think we were ahead at one point during the game, and I mean, Clemson's a good opponent. We knew that going in there, and you know, we got down. It was just a matter of not panicking. It was good to see how a lot of the new guys were going to respond to that, not having been in that situation before. And you know, the bench was pretty calm, pretty quiet. It was just, you know, one shift after the next, and they went out and they tied it up. That was a really nice goal by Reed. And went into the overtime, and we just, you know, started throwing names out, and guys went out, and they wanted it, and they proved it, and Ryan Kinney got that goal.
Ryan Kinney, one of the new members to this team nonetheless. It's a big goal, but when you talk about road games, what is the mental mindset, the takeaways, especially at this Clemson game, where you do have to travel a considerable distance to go play one game and hop right back up to North Carolina before hosting the Stephen Russell Memorial Tournament? What's the mindset going into those types of games?
It's really just, you know, we talk about what we know of the opponent, you know, before the game, and it's really business as usual. You know, everybody knows what their assignment is, and, you know, the rink, it doesn't really matter where we play. You know, it's not like it's anything different as far as, you know, like we play it on the NHL size. We play at the Olympic at home. That's really all their options are. And they went in, and, you know, it was a nice arena. You know, it wasn't just a regular local rink, you know. It was a nice place, and the guys kind of liked it, and they had a fairly good crowd there, and it was nice. Yeah, it was a good job.
And the two wins set NC State at 3-0-0 heading into the Stephen Russell Memorial Tournament. And this is where we pause. Stephen, of course, was lost to the Wolfpack family in 2009 in a tragedy on July 4th. Can you talk about what this tournament means to the NC State Wolfpack hockey family, to his own family, and really the community at large here in Raleigh?
I mean, you never really want to be in a position where you have to do something like this. But, you know, nobody on the team knows him at this point or knew him. So it's not really about that as much as just letting the memory live on. And I know his parents are excited about what we've been able to do. You know, when I got here, we had a hard time kind of getting it going and then joining with the ACC. And, I mean, it's been great. It's been huge. We get great turnout. Parents are really excited about it. And for us to be able to come out and win, they were very excited about that.
Mike Wally, commissioner of the ACCHL, has done a tremendous job getting this to be a large event. A record 14 teams participated, all 13 from the ACCHL, as well as the University of Pennsylvania. They were able to come down and participate. It's a huge event, and for NC State, what better way to start off the tournament than by playing arguably on paper the best team in the conference, the Virginia Cavaliers, the only team that beat NC State in the regular season last year. Was there a little bit of revenge pent up by your players for this game?
I think you could probably say that. You know, you always want to win your games, right? We've discussed that. And just going into that, knowing that they beat us in our tournament last year, that was the only ACC game we lost last year. So, yeah, there is a little bit of revenge factor. Even though we beat them in the ACC end of season tournament, it was still, you know, we don't really want them to have any dominance in our building.
And that one was to finish the year off on a high note. And what essentially functions as the bronze medal game in that ACCHL tournament. But you mentioned it in your second period interview, the effort may not have been there, the execution may not have been there, but at the end of the day, a win is a win. How happy were you after all three periods, after all 60 minutes, that you were able to get the W?
Yeah, well, obviously we were happy about getting a win in an ACC game. You know, I'm not always happy about, like I said, the effort at times, or, you know, how we go about getting a win is as important to me as the win. So, yeah, I was happy on one extent that we did win, but yet on the other side, I knew it kind of gave us the understanding that we had some work to do. You know, now that we're playing some of the tougher opponents that we have on our schedule, you know, we really want to make a much better showing.
And after sort of a celebration Saturday morning of at least the Stephen Russell Memorial Tournament with a couple of All-Star games, a couple of service member games, you then have to come back on Saturday night and face arguably the strongest team that you have a rivalry with now. And I would use the word rivalry in the Georgetown Hoyas. I mean, this is a team that, it's like a gnat. They're always right there buzzing. They're never going to go away. This is a team you beat in the regular season in 2012, lose to in the ACCHL Finals in 2013, beat in the regular season in 2013, lose to in the ACCHL Finals of 2014, beat in 2015, luckily didn't have to play them in the tournament again, and now you have to start that series all over with them again this year. And this was a huge game because now it was all about jockeying position to get to that Stephen Russell Memorial Tournament championship game. You're able to get the win 8-5. What's your thought process on the execution and the way your team played to get such a convincing win?
I think the best part of our game was the third period. Other than that, I mean, we pretty much got what we thought we'd get out of them. They're a strong team. They're just going to keep coming. It's going to take everybody firing on all cylinders. We went out. We played hard. But the third period really turned it around for us, and I was really happy to see that. I knew they had it in them because we did it in Clemson, right? So we knew we had it in them. It was just a matter of going out and executing.
And the turning point you're referencing, NC State has the lead, and then Georgetown ties the hockey game about midway through the second before the Wolfpack finally surge and make it 6-4 at the end of that second period. You turn around the next morning, and you get this big question mark on the schedule that is the St. Joseph's Hawks. This is a team new to the ACCHL, really uncharted territory, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, the first team in the conference ever from the state of Pennsylvania. You didn't really know what to expect from them. They hadn't been statistically impressive necessarily. When you play a team that you haven't seen before, what do you have to go out and do?
Do our job. I mean, if you have somebody that you've never seen, you don't know much about, again, you could look at what they did last year, but that doesn't matter what's going on this year because college teams change from year to year. And we're just going to go out. We're just going to do the little things, and we're going to do the things right. We're going to play hard, 60 minutes of hockey, and, you know, we'll see where that lands us.
You end up beating the Redhawks by a final count of 9-1. That really sort of puts a stamp on the weekend, but winning by that big of a margin, was any of that motivated by getting to the championship game, by trying to win your own tournament, bring the trophy home? Or is that just a matter of complete and total hockey dominance?
No, I mean, I know that on the bench the guys are talking about, hey, we need another goal to win the period. Don't let them score so we don't tie the period. So that was, honestly, it was on their minds a lot more than it was on mine. But it was just going out playing hard. They knew that was like kind of the small term goal was the tournament, but the big term goal is the ACC. We don't want any ACC games to cost us in the long run. So they went out, they took care of business, and then they realized where they were in terms of winning periods, and then they went out and they finished that off.
On Saturday night, the Duke Blue Devils clinched their spot in the Stephen Russell Memorial Tournament game. Most of that was due to the fact they performed so well in the skills competition Saturday afternoon. NC State had to hop the James Madison Dukes and their dreaded rival, the North Carolina Tar Heels, to even be able to get into the championship game. And it was an odd scenario because James Madison came into their final game against the University of North Carolina at Charlotte as favorites. And somehow the 49ers just pulled out an outstanding ice hockey game, a full 60-minute effort, beat the Dukes. Your team has to get in the locker room, get dressed, and get prepared to take on an in-state rival in a championship game. Can you explain really the chaos that was going on down at ice level getting prepared for that game?
We knew in the morning after we beat St. Joe's, we knew pretty much there was a chance that four teams could finish 3-0. Carolina being one of them, Duke we already knew, JMU had to play. So it was kind of up to them to lose the game for us to get in it. Probably around 3 o'clock I got a phone call at home from Sam. Hey, Charlotte's up 3-0. So he was sending emails out to everybody, get to the rink, get your gear. And we got there. I mean, by the time the first game settled down and the refs got there, everybody had pretty much got there, one guy late. But, at that point, they knew what they had to do. There was no more worrying about points, no more worrying about winning the periods, just go out and win the game, and they went out and they executed.
Without a doubt, they most certainly did. It was the first game of potentially what could be four games against the Duke Blue Devils this year. This one, they added on two more scheduled, as well as a possible matchup in the ACCHL tournament, should it come to that. But you look at this game against the Duke Blue Devils. This is a Duke team that, at least right now, has my vote for the turnaround team of the year, and we're not even four full games into the season for everybody. This Duke team was walked all over last year, and they came out and not only showed their skill, but their ability to win hockey games. What was it like to beat the competition that has now been Duke and still assert the dominance that it is Wolfpack hockey when it comes to North Carolina?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great time. Anytime you beat Duke or, any of your in-state rivals, it's great. They've definitely picked up some guys. They've picked up the game, and I think that's great. You don't want to have a situation where you're always going in and, kind of dominating a team. You'd rather have much more of a game, and I thought they showed a lot, and I think they have a lot of promise. And so it was better winning a game like that than winning a game maybe 9 or 10-0 against somebody you completely can dominate,
And of course, then NC State finishes up the longest stretch of their season at home by playing the Elon Phoenix. That game was last Saturday, so not too far removed from it. And this is a game, an Elon team that was a 4-2 matchup when played on the road, and it seemed like from the get-go, your Wolfpack team was firing on all cylinders, and this was a blowout from the get-go, a final count of 8-2. Describe your team's performance for us.
Yeah, I was very proud of them. We had a really strong weekend, and we talked about a lot of good things. A lot of good things came out of that in terms of like points for and power play goals, and that was stuff we talked about during the week, and I wanted them to feel good about themselves, and I also wanted them to realize that Elon beat Georgetown the first time they'd ever done that in that tournament. So, Elon was feeling pretty good about themselves. So if you want to take your momentum and match their momentum, well, then, you got to come in and you got to go hard for 60 minutes, and they did that, and it was great to see.
And finally, running the probability rankings, NC State has a 75% chance of winning their division according to our metrics. If the tournament started today, the ACCHL end of the season tournament, would you be confident sending this team that you have forward to try to win an Admiral's Cup?
Absolutely. Yeah, there's no question about that.
NC State remains 8-0-0. Their next games will be at Virginia Tech, And then the night before homecoming, North Carolina comes to town. We'll preview those games as well as some of the most important and highest performing players on this NC State hockey team on the other side of the break. You're watching Over the Boards with Mike Gazzillo on Wolfpack Sports Television, bringing you into the pack.
Check out our menu. Choose from a variety of fresh ingredients. Check out our salsa. Watch your burrito being made. Enjoy Moe's Nose Catering, burritos, tacos, and more.
Back on location here to Moe's Southwest Grill in Cameron Village. I'm Drew Blevins alongside Mike Gazzillo. Second half of Over the Boards with Mike Gazzillo. Again, our sponsor, Moe's Southwest Grill, Cameron Village. You can visit them at 919.catering.moe's.com or call them by phone 919-999-3999. Coach, we talked about the games that have been, but before we get into the future games, let's talk about some of the players that have been making a big impact already through these first eight games. And we start in the goaltender's crease with Joey Hall. I mean, this is a freshman kid who is filling in really senior-sized shoes with the loss of Nick Kamaris. 7-0-0 right now, and this kid is rolling.
Yeah, he's playing great. I mean, Brian had two of the games. He's playing great. It's nice that, you know, when we found out we were going to not have Calvin for a little while, that he was able to step right up, and he's handled the pressure really well, and the guys rally around him. Very happy for him.
I mean, that does bring up the question, though. Once Calvin Stone does get healthy, now do you have a competition for the starting goaltender on your hands? And if you do, is that really a bad problem to have?
One hand, it's a bad problem, and on one hand, it's a good problem to have. Honestly, you know, I'm not really going to address too much of that. You know, we'll see how Calvin handles coming back from the injury. Some guys come back and are not even affected by it, and some guys, you know, don't come back as strong as they were. I'm pretty confident Calvin's probably still staying in shape where he can. I'm sure he's staying mentally strong. He just sees this as a setback. It's not an end-all. He's got plenty of hockey left for us. I'll just assess him when he gets back, and we'll go from there.
It's certainly good to see him around the rink at the end of the Stephen Russell Memorial Tournament, as well as throughout that weekend. Seemed to be in fairly good spirits and staying in decent shape. You move up the blue line now, and this is one of the new players, a Swedish defenseman. And it really does sound like one of those Paul Bunyan tales that this guy comes out of nowhere and automatically makes an impact, and that's Simon Lechter. And, I mean, this is a kid who plays defense, hard nose, grit, determination, body checks on the back end, but also has the speed and offensive capability of hopping up and scoring on a breakaway, as we've seen him done twice, if not more times, at home. This kid is an all-around weapon. What can you tell us about him?
Kind of reminds me a little bit of Nate Sprankle in that he can kind of dominate situations when he's out there. I think he's playing great. You know, he's got the green light to go. The guys are covering for him. And if going with the puck is the thing to do, that's great. But he also knows that if the pass is the play, that's what he's got to do. I'm real happy with him. I knew a little bit about him before he joined the team. So it pretty much exceeded my expectations.
Well, and he does claim his Swedish heritage, which is simply outstanding. Now, you would know the history of the team more than I would. Is this one of the first foreign players, true foreign players, that NC State has ever been able to have on this team?
The only other guy that I'm aware of is Chris Lons, who is from Czech Republic.
So history being made, Simon Lechter continues to step in. And now we move up one more step, and we talk about a guy, a returning player, who has made an immediate offensive impact, 4 goals against Elon, and that's Sam Banishevitz. I mean, this is a kid who brings his game in, game out, and is always an offensive threat to whoever he's playing against.
Yeah, he's got one speed. It's fast. He loves scoring goals. He'll be happy to tell you that. He loves the celebrations. He'll be happy to tell you that, too. And we love seeing it. So The more the guys can get the puck to him, the more confidence we have in his abilities. And he's been a very good good player for us, good inspiration for the new guys.
Well, and even more to go along with his skill, what is his value as a showman? I mean, he's got a presence on social media. He's got his own little fan club. I mean, this kid is a practical superstar whenever he walks out on the ice.
I didn't know he had a fan club. I'm going to start hanging out with him a little more, apparently. I mean, he's got a presence wherever he goes, and I mean, that's great. People feed off of him, and, you know, he's got leadership ability, and, you know, he handles it right, so more power to him.
And barring any unforeseen circumstances, the next place he will be going is to Virginia Tech. Turning right back around, going to the Berglund Center, a place your team did not fare so well last year, 5-1 loss. This is the opening leg of a home-and-home series with the Hokies. This is a Hokies team, once again, ranked in the ACHA Southeast Division. This is a huge game for your team to start gleaning votes and climbing up those rankings. What are you expecting from the effort come Friday night?
Just what we've been doing. I mean, just stick with the game plan. It's when you do the rankings, what I found out was it counts more how you play on the road than a win at home and a win on the road. Obviously, that counts a little more. And, you know, the guys know what they have to do. They've shown that they can do it. They've shown what they had to do when they come from behind. And I expect them to go out there, and I just expect them again. If we get 60 minutes of hockey out of them, I'll put them up against anybody.
Well, this is a Virginia Tech team that is probably going to be the fastest and most offensively skilled team that you've seen. And one of the things that sets themselves apart from the rest of the Southeast is their neutral zone attack. They're able to get the presence from their own blue line and move the puck through two-thirds of the ice with solid control. How do you break that up?
Just aggressive on the forecheck. Knowing where your position is, knowing who your check is, being aggressive on it. Just try to watch. Just try to, you know, I guess kind of use that cliche of read-react. Just try to play them, see what they're doing, and just try to counter it.
And, of course, you can listen to that game live on 88.1 WKNC as Wolfpack Sports Television will be sponsoring to cover the rest of the road games, that NC State Hockey will play over the radio waves. More information can be found on our Facebook page, Vimeo page, any of our social media sites where you can find out more information about our radio broadcast. And then, Coach, the night after the homecoming parade, North Carolina comes to town. And really, all pun intended, the Tar Heels have been a little bit of a goat. They have not played nearly as well as people would have anticipated. I mean, this is a team that just won the league in 2015 in astounding fashion, and now they have laid an egg in every sense of the word. But surely this is a game that you're not going to want to overlook. The way you went out last year to this team, are you looking to pile drive these guys into the ground?
I'm looking to put our best foot forward. I'm looking for the guys to give a 60-minute, 100% effort. I really don't think there's a lot that I can or need to say to them about what this game means. They saw it on the schedule. It's been circled since day one. They're ready to go for it. We're not looking past Virginia. But once we get past Virginia, we're all set for Carolina. I mean, in a game like this, it really doesn't matter what a team's been doing. Everything's different. Everything's different. So I expect that they're going to come out. You know, they want it. You know, they want to show that they beat us last year. They could do it again. And we want to show that, you know, that was a fluke. So drop the puck and let's go.
So North Carolina comes to town. Special start time for that game, 9:45 p.m. The next time that will be the start time for an NC State home game will be in February. Of course, we will let you know that once it gets closer to that game time. But, Coach, I'm going to give you free rein over the mic here. I mean, what is your call to students to create an atmosphere, to create a place that is difficult for the Tar Heels to play in, to create a true home ice advantage? This is a student crowd at NC State that set a record for the single largest crowd at a club sporting event last year. Are they going to surpass that record? Free reign.
If you've never seen the game, you don't know what you're missing. I think the conversation that goes around school, the conversation that goes around the team, the social media and stuff, it speaks for itself. There are not too many events that are like it. So I would definitely encourage them to come down a night before Halloween and see some real good hockey.
And, of course, the night of Halloween, the night of Halloween, the NC State football team hosts ranked Clemson University. So an all-around great sports weekend to be in Raleigh. After you get off of that weekend, it's a little bit of downtime, and then you head on the road to face the University of North Carolina at Wilmington. This Seahawks team is really the hidden gem of Southern hockey right now because they're nestled away. Nobody really wants to go down there to play them. And yet somehow, year in, year out, they turn in a great hockey team down there.
Yeah, they got a great – they do. They have a great program. They got, you know, a nice little rink that they play at. They get fan involvement just like we do. It's probably one of the other – only venues that gets the place packed that I've seen, and they have a great team, and they look forward to playing us, and it's always a difficult time when we go down there. I mean, I can't explain it, but it always is a difficult time for us to get down there and play them, but we're looking forward to that as well.
And then you got to turn right back around, head back north to play the Wake Forest Demon Deacons, a team that you've beaten. And this really starts these two-game-a-weekend trends from now until you get Virginia Tech at home on December 4th before the big Christmas break.
Yeah, you know, we knew that going into this. We basically had one game planned, especially at the beginning before the tournament, just so we can try to tweak things a little bit. Now it's just kind of worked out that we only have the games with one, weekends with one game. But, yeah, I mean, it's more of what we like. We like two games in a weekend. The fact that we beat Wake Forest doesn't really mean much, not to me at least. Again, and you know, I know their coach, and he's a new guy, and he's working with them, and he's going to have them ready, and I expect a much tougher game than we played them the first time.
Wake Forest does have a very young squad, but a tremendous goaltending tandem of David Ostrowski and Cody Colangelo that could pose issues. And then next weekend, the weekend following that, at High Point, you go down to Winston-Salem in the Annex to play the Panthers down there before coming back home to play Charlotte. And Charlotte has been sort of that Achilles heel team for NC State. You're able to beat them at home, and somehow they find ways to win at their place down in Indian Trail. Can you explain this sort of dynamic between these two teams? Because even before Charlotte came into the league, they've always been right there and a constant opponent for NC State.
No, I can't explain it. I really don't know. It's one of those things. We go down there, and it's tough. I mean, it's tough when we're here. I mean, there's no blowouts. I mean, they've been a tough opponent since I can remember playing them. Now they're in our conference, so now there's that added dimension to the game of winning, so you beat your in-conference opponent. Obviously, it's ACC points as well. So, I mean, I expect big things from them. I expect them to be ready. I know they're a good team, but I know we've got a good team, so, again, drop the puck, and I'm ready for them.
Coach, this is one of the single best starts in the history of NC State hockey, now 8-0-0. And these aren't wins, aside from Clemson and aside from Elon, arguably, that you're just squeaking them out. These are statement, period, exclamation point victories. How confident are you in this team moving forward?
I'm as confident as I could possibly be. They've exceeded my expectations, you know, with so many new guys, not necessarily freshmen, but, you know, just some of the guys that are new, even though they're upperclassmen. You know, you're always worried about the chemistry. You're always worried about how they're going to be in a locker room, how they're going to be on the bench, how are they going to act, you know, with a lead, with adversity. And, again, they've exceeded my expectations, and if they go 60 minutes, I put them against anyone.
And lastly, what is the factor to keeping a donut in the loss column when we see you next week, or next month, I should say?
That's a good question. The bottom line is we're going, like I told you when we first sat down earlier last month, that the goal is to win every game. And that's what we go out to do. And that's what we talk about during the week. And that's what we talk about in the locker room before the game. It's what we talk about between periods. So the fact that we're 8-0 is great, but you're always one game away from that changing, right? So it's, they know what's at stake. Nothing ever changes from one game to the next. We're going out. The past is history, and we're looking to make some history. And they're going to go. They go hard. We're good to go.
Coach, thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
That will wrap up the second episode of Over the Boards with Mike Gazzillo of this, the fifth season of the show. As always, we have to thank our sponsors, Moe's Southwest Grill. You can visit them at 919.catering.moes.com. 919-999-3999, or come on down and visit them live on location right where we shoot every third Friday of the month at Cameron Village. He's the man behind the mustache, head coach Mike Gazzillo, and I'm Drew Blevin signing off. You've been watching Over the Boards with Mike Gazzillo, a production of Wolfpack Sports Television. We'd like to thank our wonderful technical team, and we will see you back here in a month. Good night, everybody.
Check out our menu. Choose from a variety of fresh ingredients. Check out our salsa. Watch your burrito being made. Enjoy Moe's Nose Catering, burritos, tacos, and more.